All right, we are in. Oh, this is endorsed by the Japanese Shogi Association. That's cool. Hey, 5 Don logged in. Now on a 5-game winning streak. Can I just watch a game? You know, let's take like this game here. Ba-da-da-doom. All right. Oh. Okay. Yeah. No, I totally don't understand what just happened there. Does anybody understand it? Black resigned. I don't see any black pieces. Okay. Well, the game concluded. Whoever was playing black lost the game, which is unfortunate for that player. I've actually played this game before. But if you can't guess already, I was not particularly good at it. Like, what's so good about White's position here? Is Black the one who just moved this pawn that's about to get killed 2 different ways? Or is that not a pawn? It sure looks like a pawn. Oh. Okay, so move 56 was white moving pawn takes S or 6g. Pawn takes gold here. And the final move was the player who just lost their gold gave up the game. I could see why that might be potentially upsetting. Okay. Yeah, let's go back to the lobby. Exit game. Okay, thankfully, just takes us back to the lobby. Let's go watch. Yeah, Seattle 81. Whoever that is. USA. USA. Okay. All right. So both players have castled to the right. In terms of pawn structure, nobody has any doubled pawns yet. Because, you know, I'm the pawn doubler of this game. Looks like a pawn's about to cross the river. Oh. Wait, what? Okay, so that pawn limits the knight. And the gold. So now we promote our knight. And then gold take. No, that's a. I don't know if that's a gold or a silver. Either way, surely the player whose turn it is. I guess black is on the bottom of the board in this case. Black is just going to kill that piece, right? You're saying it's even better to lure that out. But why? I guess if that particular type of general, which I think is a silver, if that moves off the diagonal, then the bishop takes the lance. and becomes a dragon bishop. Oh, the red piece means it's promoted. So we have a promoted whatever that is that got over there. Some promoted piece that now moves like a gold, but I'm not sure what kind of piece it was originally. Wait, is that a promoted bishop? Also, if that's a promoted bishop, didn't it just move into the line of fire of that pawn? Like, his pawn takes this piece not a legal move? Am I just being dumb? What's going on here? Because seriously, if pawn takes that piece as a legal move, then it's probably a good one. Because that looks like a pretty valuable piece to take. I wonder if I can boost anything about this window size. No, it's the window size is locked. I'll see like settings, personal settings. Oh, darn it, that interferes with our display of the game. Large. Oh yeah. There we go. That's better. It's a bit large for my display, but yeah, that shows up a lot better. Oh wait, this is a bishop or some piece belonging to the opponent. That's why pawn takes is not happening, because this is friendly with respect to this pawn. Okay, so it looks like the upper player, who I think is white, is attacking the king. There's currently three knights that are closing in, although knights are kind of clumsy in shogi. So either he'll figure out what to do with the rook, or he'll hesitate. All right, that's doing something with the rook, but that is exchanges rooks at best. Which might be a good thing for your piece placement. Oh, that's right. When the rook goes backwards, it promotes. Okay, so now we have a bishop that's promoted, that's attacking the king. The opponent wants to place a pawn, but at the same time doesn't want to give up their bishop. So they're going to have to spend a turn retreating it or sacrificing it. Oh, we're looking at a sacrifice, guys. Yeah, there it is. Right, the idea of pinning the silver and hoping to exploit that pin somehow. It's risky, but shogi has plenty of risky. Oh, there we go. That's what I was missing. That back rank attack. Now, will that piece by itself be enough? Who knows? You're going to need more pieces to support it, but. Yeah, right. So that rook's going to capture the lance and promote. Probably. I think a promoted rook still. Yeah, promoted bishop or rook still retain their rook or bishop powers, in addition to the gold powers they get. Oh, this is shogi, guys. Sorry about that. Let me mark this accordingly. This is shogi proper. It just has US style pieces. What, is that pawn gonna wage the entire war on its own? If so, that's a bold strategy. Yeah, you need to defend your king. You don't have time to place the rook way over there. You have to make some kind of balance between attack and a defense. And you got tons of weak points to deal with. Now, why not gold takes gold? Oh, because that gold's defended. That hurts. Alright, yeah, black's defense is crumbling. Ever so slowly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it looks like our U.S. Friend forgot about that checkmate. Can you? Surely you can place checkmate. What the heck? I do not understand. All right, pawns don't move like chess pawns. So that's, oh, but right, no, that knight would have defended on that 8. I assume that's the g8 square. Yeah, the knight would have already defended g8, so gold at g8 would have been checkmate. Yeah, upside down pieces are that of your opponent. This is seriously looking really terrible for black. Check. You have to block with something, or run your king even further up the board, which occasionally, very rarely, does work. But when it works, your king is kind of invincible on the other side. Yeah, no, he does have to prepare to run. But, oh, wait, no, the gold just mates him. So, running is fatal. Yeah, he's got to go this way. He still made it, though, I guess. Yeah, that sure looks like mate. That's mate. GG. What a game. What a show. Alright, next one. 3 Don versus 1 Don. Alright, so we see black is playing the bottom set. White is playing the top set. Black has a bishop and pawn in hand. And it is a 3 Don, which is 2 ranks higher than 1 Don. So, the player on bottom, black that is a favorite here, It looks like we've just advanced out of the opening stage. I am extremely confused by the fact that, well, oh no, both players have a bishop in hand. Still interesting that the pawn, that a hole was exposed such that a pawn could get placed up that far on the board. That's surely a diversion so that the rook can go ahead and take the pawn on h3. Yeah, unfortunately, the USA is not playing in this game. Sorry. This is the target. This is the other target. You have to convince some Zug addict someday to become amazing at this game. Although he cleaned my clock, I think, multiple times. It was still fun, but he's like insanely good at seeing tactics. Like some sort of wizard. I don't know how. Like, if there's a tactic that's super ultra complicated, he finds it. He's good, but then occasionally gets distracted. And it's when he gets distracted that I have hope. So that bishop probably retreats. Yep. So that's a promoted bishop, so it can move like a gold general, basically one square in any direction. Or it can move like a bishop. So that is one powerful piece. The threat is bishop takes silver. Oh wait, no, then rook takes bishop. Never mind. I saw that. But yeah, one thing I tend to like to do in this game is to double my pawns. Turns out that that's not legal in shogi. So I end up losing numerous games to two doubled pawns. Probably more than any other active player on the site. Not that I'm that active. But usually in the positions where I'm doing it, I'm dead lost anyway, and doubling my pawns in desperation. Because usually when I'm attacking, I'm like, whoa, before I do this pawn drop, I better be careful about where I'm putting it. That is one far advancing pawn, but there's nothing to stop it. Interesting. In theory, black could do silver to g3, I'm sorry, g7, intending that if this pawn ever advances, then silver captures it. And then the silver is supported by the rook. Problem is, then your silver's pinned to your rook. So each kind of piece usually moves differently. So you have to be careful not to trap your pieces. That's more aggressive. for sure. Well, so the obvious threat is just advance the pawn and then advance it one more square to promote it. And once promoted, it can like take the knight or take the rook. That's the obvious threat in this position. Surely Black's not entirely missing that point. And surely he has something planned against this, even though I don't see what. Probably trying to counter the threat with a more important threat. But where? What, why, and how? Oh, so now if the pawn advances, you just capture it. And if the pawn does not advance, you capture it anyway. So what if knight takes? Knight takes, knight takes, rook takes. And then you do something to hit the rook, I guess? Oh, well, we're not doing that. We're instead placing our pieces in our opponent's face. Even though that's just a bishop. When it moves backwards, like it's threatening to capture this pawn. So I guess this is an idea. Then it promotes as it retreats. Another nasty idea might be way out here. I'm not exactly sure what's going on, but it looks like Black has played aggressively and White is playing even more aggressively. So that's gonna make for an interesting fight. All right, we're sacrificing our rook, and allowing our opponent to promote. So that helps accelerate their attack, but they're attacking an empty space on the board. So now we have a bishop in hand to complement the bishop that we already have on the board that's already promoted, that can move like a general. What's the big idea? Where would that second bishop even want to go? It's weird having only a bishop in hand. Anybody know? Euler? Euler? Yeah, this does not look like a pleasant situation. Wow, he's really slowed down a lot. I thought he had something really concrete prepared. I'm wondering now if he was just outwitted from the start. Or maybe he's preparing something very complex involving I don't even know what. Really building a solid castle and trying to hole up and hope nothing bad happens. Which, whenever I try to do something like that, there's always a flaw. The invaders always go right through the front door. But maybe he sees something. Or possibly, yeah, White has just played this very accurately. Or maybe Black is distracted or tired or I don't know. Either way, this is the fact that Black is spending forever on this move either indicates that there's something worth really deeply reflecting about here, or he's just something not involving the game is occupying his time. Could be a personal matter, it could be an internet connection issue, although probably not. It could be me just not viewing the game correctly. It could be some kind of protest, although that seems ridiculous. I don't know. To me, it sure looks like that rook that White has is exactly on the right place to cover every square, horizontally and vertically. Just cooperating beautifully with the castle that White has built. So I'm not seeing a flaw or a weakness anywhere. But again, what do I know about shogi? So Black might just need to hole up and find a way to survive some sort of attack. All right, now Black has entered Byo-Yomi. If that timer now reaches zero, that's game. Wow. Okay. Well, so Black had to move. This sacrifices a bishop for a gold. I guess he spent as long as possible just to try to plan out what's going to happen next. Like I was saying, I don't see a weakness. Worst case, I mean, that bishop can't even retreat. I guess it could only advance, but thankfully for the bishop, the square it can advance to would be checkmate. So this is a brinkmate, not a very subtle one, and not one where the bishop has any retreating squares. So this is a highly committal move. So what does White do about the brinkmate? Does he have to offer back the exchange? Can he do bishop t or sorry, gold takes bishop? That is, can this gold take there? I hesitate to even make the arrow because spectators are going to be like, this guy is dumb. I'm sure that like if gold takes bishop were convincingly a strong move, it would be played already. Now, Lance can go forward, but it cannot move backward. So, moving it forward out of danger would not stop the checkmate. Yeah, you need to defend that A2 square. As for how you do it, your guess is as good as mine. This must be a really challenging position. How deep are these guys calculating? mean, to me, it seems like you either do gold takes, or you move your gold to B2. Okay. Or I was gonna say, otherwise, you have to put your rook at B2. Because moving your silver to B2 means that bishop takes gold happens, and that's no good. Okay, so the bishop does move in that direction anyway, but it does threaten to take the silver. So that's a legitimate threat. That does defend the silver. So now the bishop has no squares to retreat to. Could it move toward the king? That square next to the knight would be safe. We're seeing a bishop sacrifice. So either that gold was exactly the piece he needed, or the gold and the silver together were exactly the pieces he needed, or he's just being really aggressive. Okay, so knight takes silver as a threat. So, yeah, the question in everybody's mind here is which attack goes through first? So that bishop all the way over here on h1 is pretty far from the king. Bishops do move swiftly, but I think white has quite a strong castle and has a couple of rooks, so rooks can be devastating for knocking pieces out laterally. Big surprise, right? Ding, 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 ding. All right, we see bishop takes lance, transferring the bishop from the one color complex to the other color complex if you're dealing with a standard chessboard, but we don't have light or dark squares here, do we? I wonder when it was decided that some battlefields have tiles that are alternating color and some don't. I wonder what the history behind that is. Okay, so we've got a dragon on h9 and a promoted bishop, which I think is also a dragon, I'm not sure. I don't know what to call it. Okay, so that protects against the dragon. Are these players ever going to place their pieces? Hey, MC. Alright, so that adds another defender to White's castle. Interesting that like White's got all kinds of lateral entry points, but Black has no rook. And I'm sure the opposite is true with like diagonal entry points and White not having a bishop. So this exchange sacrifice, if you will, of the rook for bishop really changes the character of your castle and how you defend it. So here, White's got a rook, White's got another rook. He doesn't want to trade his rooks for anything. And so Black is having fun just harassing this diagonally because he's got the two bishops. At least I thought he did. Where'd the other bishop go? Oh, there it is. It's not yet re-entered play as the opponent's piece. He did end up sacrificing a rook for bishop, and then sacrificing a bishop for two pieces, for two generals, a gold and a silver. six, five, four. Okay. Well, that's defended for sure. It's mainly attacking this pawn over here. Oh, and because White doesn't have a pawn in this file, he can just plunk one down anywhere he wants on this file. So a pawn could be coming here. Okay, so we're exchanging bishops to slow down this attack. Now we got a bishop in hand that's not a promoted bishop. We still have this threat of silver takes gold, although adding more pieces in this vicinity will help the attack become even more effective. There's a concept again of threat is always stronger than the execution, so you just want to keep building that threat until that castle splits wide apart, I suppose. I'm no shogi expert. Oh, check that out. Spiffy. That is a cool defense. I assume we're gonna see some piece enter the game over here. Can't be a pawn. It might be a lance, just to block that attack. Nope. Black is going for it. He says, enough with waiting. Let's see just what damage I can deal. That's admirable, but is that gonna work? Okay, I guess he's got several pieces in hand, but no rook. I guess, yeah, now if he had a knight could enter play on c4. He doesn't have a knight. This knight's attacked, but that's. You can't count that until you have it. Alright, your bishop. Ooh, this is not going well for black, I don't think. You don't want your bishop getting harassed like this. So we're probably going to see bishop takes pawn. Because the bishop really doesn't have very many other places to go. Yeah, there it is. Bishop takes pawn. Yeah, I don't think this is going well for black. Black does have quite a castle, but from what I've played of Shogi and of Crazy House, I don't trust castles. Trust with two T's, that is. I'd much rather have the pieces and be the one attacking. Well, that does compel the bishop to move. Basically, White's not going to sack a bishop just on a whim. Not sure where the bishop goes. I mean, okay, that's obvious, but I wasn't sure about it. Does this. Unlike in chess, where you can promote a pawn and take a queen, in shogi, when you promote a pawn, it becomes a promoted pawn. And it doesn't move like a queen, it doesn't move like a rook, or like a ranged piece. It moves like a general. which is a very short range piece. So the idea that, hey, look, we got this wide open H or I file, we could start placing and promoting pawns is kind of silly. I think the double pawn rule only apply. Oh, nice. We found a weakness. White overpressed. No, white could take that pawn though. Bishop takes pawn. And we get a bishop exchange, but that's not what white was counting on. In fact, yeah, this makes more sense. Because if a bishop exchange happens, then black just drops a bishop here. Or puts, say, gold there or silver there or something. Black is attempting to approach this castle, and this pawn does put a foothold right at the doorway. So that does bring black a little bit closer. We see an exchange sack. Well, what's black gonna do now? I mean, you could place a pawn here, you could take the rook. Not sure what else you could do. Could place a gold there, you could place basically anything next to this. Or, yeah, you take it, and now your opponent, he has a promoted bishop. They've got a bishop in hand. You finally got a rook that helps you sweep things off the back rank. Oh, look, there's nothing on the back rank. Womp, womp. So, don't know how effective this attack's gonna be. Okay, yeah. A lance can attack a bishop. That bishop doesn't have the greatest number of safe squares to go to. I mean, bishop could go here. Okay, it does go there. Well, you think this is too slow? You think this. I don't know if 30 means too fast or too slow for spectators. Maybe some people grasp what's going on better than I do. Oh, okay, yes. Yeah, this is common. Although it can cause quite a headache for people who aren't, like, experts. Like here we have a one Don and a three Don who have played a lot of shogi. That doesn't mean this makes it any easier for them, but they're playing this as a more, we'll say, casual game. Assuming the game does allow for that kind of description. Yeah, no. For sure, they've been on this 30-second increment or Byo-Yomi for quite a few moves now. For at least over half the game. Yeah, I was going to suggest that. Might as well hit the bishop again. Just keep hitting it. Every time it moves, just hit it again. And I'm not so convinced that this exchange sacrifice was necessarily in White's favor. Given where that bishop's located now, I guess White overlooked this possibility of the gold and the lance suddenly appearing to oppose the bishop, which would otherwise be useful on this open diagonal. Yeah, this makes sense. You build like your battery up here. Your opponent has to defend. Though there should be good defending moves available. Right? Oh, wow. No, there's not. If you had a gold, you'd put the gold right here. Even that might not hold, though. Okay, yeah, I'm sorry. You have to put the silver here. What was I thinking? Yeah, the point is that this remains defended. I was initially thinking, what if you just put the silver there and hit the rook? But then gold takes silver's check, and you're forced to do silver takes gold, I guess. It's not really a threat on the rook. And then with silvers, your opponent's attack could maybe become stronger, I'm not sure. Oh, I'm sorry, no, I saw that variation. I saw, well, if you put your silver here, there you have gold takes silver, threatening to take the silver next. I think. No. I'm wrong. Would time per game work? Well, the problem is, so you've probably played Crazy House, and you know how in Crazy House, basically every game ends in a time scramble. And that's kind of the point of Crazy House, is that it's completely insane. It can drag on for any number of moves, and usually ends either by checkmate or by a player flagging on the clock. Time per game would cause a similar effect here in Shogi, and I think that's why they don't do it. Because you never know how many moves the game's going to go for. This, you could have a game that goes potentially for hundreds of moves, or it could go for dozens of moves. You don't know. So, I think because you can drop pieces that re-enter the game, it's really difficult to estimate how much time remains. So I think that's why they do Byo-Yomi instead of time per game. Ooh, we sack a rook. What? Could that rook not be taken? There must have been something there. I don't have time to look at it. Oh, I'm sorry. We have so many pieces lined up right there on the rank. That rook was defended by a gold. Yeah. Oh, wait, is that mate? No. Yes. GG. Yeah, what I missed earlier is that when this rook took here, or when it went there, that the king couldn't take that because this was a gold belonging to black here. All right, so we're gonna deconstruct the mating attack, I suppose. There is a comment window. I can't get the comment window to show up while I have the board zoomed in this far. And plus, these guys are talking in Japanese anyway, so I don't understand it. But this must have been an important position. I was surprised to see this bishop over here. Yeah, why didn't the bishop just go back this way toward the king to help secure all that? This bishop never really ended up entering the attack. White's attack just really slowed down as soon as these entered the board to cut off the bishop. Yeah, Lucky Shark got lucky. Wait, we're sacking a bishop for a lance? Then promoting a pawn? How does that make any sense? Is that promoted pawn devastating in some sense? Like, why would you do that? That seems uncalled for. A lance is like the least valuable piece, a bishop is the most valuable. Well, no, a rook's the most valuable if you promote it. Yeah, I guess what he was saying is that he was looking at some crazy variation involving those moves, and it just completely does not work somehow. Okay, that makes more sense. Sacking it for whatever piece that was that we just took, which, I'm sorry, that was a gold. And put another bishop down where that used to be. The least valuable piece you can drop with here is a pawn, which actually might suffice. Just put a pawn on that center square. Oh no, the bishop just takes it. It's not defended by the lance only goes forward. So yeah, that was kind of a diode here. Like the lance was protecting this and plugging that up, so once you took this piece, the lance opens up and you can place the other bishop and now you have free rein on the diagonal. Which maybe works. I don't know. Maybe. It's a thought. Maybe not. Maybe it feels. Maybe sack a knight. Just place it right in front of the pawn, saying, if you don't take me, I'm going to start taking things. Okay. Note that black already has a pawn up here, so you can't drop a pawn there. So you have to drop your least valuable thing or a knight there. So least valuable, I guess, was a gold. Bishop retreats and sacks with tempo. You got a promoted bishop. You sack the promoted bishop. Wait, what? Why king takes? Why not knight takes? It's okay. There's something about king safety I don't appreciate. That it's safer to do king takes than to activate your knight. I guess the active knight gives up too many crucial squares around the king. So you got a couple gold generals in hand. You got a silver kind of sort of near the king. Maybe something's going on here. I'm doubtful. I seriously doubt it, but I just got confused why this bishop went back this way instead of like trying to defend the all these useful squares this way and continue attacking, influencing this diagonal over here. But yeah. Okay. Right, so you take the promoted bishop. I guess you're gonna take this pawn. Oh, lance takes pawn. Whoa, okay. Wait. No, don't show me the cup rated thing. No, show me the game. Okay, check. Oh, this is cut off by the pawn. So you have to block with a blocker. Promoted piece could take the blocker. Stuff could happen. Maybe. I guess it's safe in the sense that once you move the knight forward, you can't move it back. So this knight controls some useful squares for this particular formation. So I guess this formation keeps pieces away at first, but I guess if pieces get past this wall, then you're in deep trouble. I'm guessing that's the point of that formation. Alright, so now we're discussing defensive tries and how that fell apart. Yeah, I don't understand the point of that. Really, it just seemed once this happened that the tide turned quite a bit. Again, I was thinking just retreat the bishop, which is crazy for a shogi game. Shogi has a lot of attacking moves, so the idea of taking one of your strongest attackers and retreating it is counterintuitive at best. But these pieces held it at bay, so it's possible that this capture of this pawn, which allowed all these positions in the center, could have been vital to what happened, maybe? What else are we gonna look at? So the lance hits the bishop. Yeah, we're gonna start looking at some. Yeah, it's just unfortunate the way that evolved with tempo. You obviously have to move the bishop. I'm saying obviously because, well, short of some sort of instant mating attack, you're facing a difficult situation here. Okay, we got a silver, but what good is that? The knight controls the squares the silver could move to, other than the square the king just ran out of. That square is not defended. So what, do you put a gold on that square? Just say, I'm going to start plunking all my pieces in this vicinity and hope something sticks. Put the bishop there. Okay, then bishop takes gold, or what's the idea? Bishop, in front of the pawn. Not even sure if that was a capture or not. That's a bit. It's not even a capture. I'm not convinced. I guess that can't be taken because a knight drop would mate in one, but. Okay, we'll try to exchange knights. Yeah, actually, that knight threat looks pretty interesting. If white had another bishop, black would be toast, but he doesn't. Okay, so the gold can only move vertically backward. So we lure it away to expose some kind of hole somewhere, I guess. Although, white's running out of attackers. Yeah, no, this move I like. The bishop cannot be taken because then this knight enters where the pawn just came from, and the knight checking here would be mate. So the bishop's invincible on that advanced square. Let's see, this lance sacrifice on b7 might have been it. Not sure if they're going to say anything more. Guess these guys are both experts, or one Don and three Don. Let's go on and look at another game, because this stuff is over my head. Alright, let's go back to the lobby. Here's two five dons duking it out at some fast time control. Well, they don't use letters for their column names. Okay, noted. At least this diagram doesn't. So we're watching two five dons have at it. Does that indicate that the one playing white, the one on right, is using a phone to play this? What's with that phone-like icon? Okay. I have no idea. I don't understand, how the rating system works. It seems like when you win enough games, your rank increases in terms of Q level, KYU for beginners, and Don level for experts, or titled experts. I guess they call them, they have designations of Don versus Pro Don or Don Pro or something. So if you win enough games, you will rank up. I think the numbers are quite similar to Elo or Glicko. I don't know exactly how that works, but I'm not sure that it makes a difference anyhow because I think you have to gain some rating points and then win some games. At least on this server, it seems that's how it works, is how you rank up. Or if you lose enough rating points and then lose some games, you rank down. Which I think is quite clever. Your number indicating your performance in terms of your rating does not depend on your rank. Only your rank depends on your rating. No, I'm wrong. No, when you hit your rating floor, and then when you start losing games, then you rank down and can lose more rating points. And when you hit your rating ceiling, you by winning some games, you rank up and can gain more rating points. That's right. I've seen actually both sides of that thing with my particular rating and rank. Somehow in one of my first games, I was playing against, I don't remember what strength of a player. I want to say a three Don, Which sounds completely nuts. Caught him off guard, where his king and his rook were exposed to a bishop drop fork. So I ended up winning a rook, promoting it. So I had a rook and a dragon and bishop all roaming around the board. I still managed to lose the game because I'm bad at shogi, but I spotted that one crazy house chess tactic there. And for some reason, the site thought that was appropriate. Oh, we have a perpetual, apparently. Okay. Didn't know that was possible. Didn't understand why the players were shuffling, but I guess all their pieces are in the ideal spots and they're done with this game. Weird. Or they just got bored. I don't know. But yeah, the site thought for whatever reason that it was appropriate to give me this ridiculously high beginner rank. And after that, my rating and ranking plummeted like a stone. If a stone could plummet, I don't know, faster than gravity could propel it downward, faster than its terminal velocity. Basically, there is no metaphor for exactly how quickly my rating plummeted, other than speaking about it in terms of my rating. I don't think you choose. No, you just play some games and it'll give you a rating and a ranking. I was just really perplexed that, okay, sure, I played this game against a strong player and held it for quite a few moves, but yeah, my initial rating and ranking didn't make any sense to me, and it was quickly confirmed that I'm not a grandmaster of this game. That became evident the next game and all the games afterward. Yeah, maybe I'm misremembering. Even so, like, I'm pretty sure I gave myself a pretty If I was offered that opportunity, I would have identified myself as a noob. And I guess the site didn't believe me or something, I don't know, because I did end up getting like a I don't want to misspeak because I don't remember. You'll have to check the video on demand to check the video archive, but I could have sworn they had like a one Don rank, which is absolutely completely nuts and undeserved in any possible way. But that problem worked itself out pretty quickly. So they're discussing this game. I don't understand any of what happened, and this game ended at a perpetual anyway, so we're never going to understand the subtler details of positional shogi. Well, hey, look, they're playing some 10-second Byo-Yomi shogi. I'm sure Greg Shahadi would love this. Hey, look how quickly they're moving. Oh no, the guy's about to lose on time. He better move. Oh no. Wow, look at the time situation. Oh my goodness. Oh, now he's only got 10 seconds. Oh, now he's got 10. Wow. I mean, Greg wouldn't be that much of a dick about it. But that's the sort of thing that some commentators do drum up over and over that they don't need to. I mean, if the time situation is that much affecting your commentary, then it's not a serious game. It could be a good fun game, it could be entertaining, it could be a fun exhibition, but to treat it with any level of gravitas, you have to make it a game worth looking at. I don't know. Yeah, he's only got 6 seconds. Oh my goodness. But yeah, commentators love shorter games because they're easier to comment on. Oh, he loses on time. Oh, no. No, not like that. Okay. Good game, I guess. Maybe. I did not expect that. You don't see two professional players duking it out like this. He tried to move his bishop, and he lost on time. Wow. Okay. That was just a mistake. So, yeah, I guess the clock situation was more important than I thought it actually was. I was just making fun of it, but apparently you can lose on time, even if you're a professional. Oh my goodness. That's unbelievable. Or, as Komarov would put it, can't believable. Wait, so are we not just promoting this rook? Okay, the rook's not attacked. You don't have to move it yet, but rook way back here is a threat. And then I guess you only have two pieces to attack with. And this is one hell of a castle here. I mean, look at that. Is that not a beautiful castle? Compared with whatever the heck this is, which is also beautiful in its own way, I just don't understand it. I wonder, what if some of these pawns start trading? What kind of barren hellscape will open up here? Okay, so we've got a wall here. This rook can't cross the wall. What? Oh. What was that? Onegaishimasu. I'm gonna assume that was some sort of compliment, welcome, or greeting. Maybe somebody joined the room and is watching with us. I don't know. One thing that was pointed out, I think, when Zug Addict and Spinal Tap or somebody were playing a shogi game, is that if you manage to get your king to the opposite side, it's very difficult for an army to attack a king that's, in a sense, promoted. Even though it's not really promoted, but it's just on the side of the board where a king operates more effectively than any attacker. So sometimes it could be impossible to checkmate a king that's advanced too far. All right, we're opening up that side of the board, maybe. Could we just take that? I suppose not. I suppose taking that's too risky because then another pawn drops right here and hits the knight, and the knight can only move into the way of traffic of these pawns. So, it ended up being safer to retreat the silver. Still looking for an opening. Still got two pawns in hand and a silver in hand. Well, don't we just put a pawn up here now? Like, right there. Oh, yeah, even better. If rook back, then are we not intending this? And this might have even been doable last turn. Okay, so that's covered now. So all entry points are covered. Except for pawn drop right here. Yes, shogi, let go, is definitely very much a game of finding balance. And we're looking at two five-dan professionals trying to outbalance each other. These games would make a lot more sense to us Americans, or, yeah, I guess us is appropriate. Look. A lot simpler to us if this were a strong player facing off against a weak player, and if this were just a beatdown then I could identify what's going on. But as it stands right now, this is kind of difficult to figure out what's going on. So, yeah, the rook's defending this, right? Rook here. You're not just going to keep placing more and more pieces, right? Oh, we launched the attack. Bishop takes silver is almost kind of sort of threatened. Not really. I suppose the real threat is that pawn up. So our silver is attacking the rook. Rook sidesteps that attack. This shuts down the bishop, so that pawn up here is not as effective as it was a turn ago. Pawns capture forward, they do not capture diagonally. Yeah, that's one thing that makes chess and shogi quite different, is just how the pawns move and how other pieces work with respect to the pawns. Okay, we sack a pawn. Right, because the least valuable attacker is a gold. So now we've lured a gold out, and we can take it with our silver, but I'm sure there's something more in mind here. Yeah, in fact, what that kibitzer was suggesting looked very strong, but just ill-timed. That kibitzer's move actually was probably better than what the five don played. Unless I missed something, but yeah, bishop takes rook is threatened. That's kind of a big threat. You can't just ignore that unless you have a mating attack to go attend to. This looks bad for black. All right, black's going all in. I'm willing to exchange my rook for your bishop. I'm just gonna hope that I've got enough to mate you. Knight takes, right? Will we see knight takes? Or is that knight needed for defense, and we just can't afford to launch any kind of real attack here? Which would be sad. Or, well, we don't have any pawns, but if we had a pawn, placing one here to lure the gold into an attack might be useful. Okay. I don't understand that move at all. The point of that might be to sacrifice the pawn, or that you're threatening to do pawn takes pawn, but that just seems tricky more than anything else. I don't see an actual benefit to it. So is now the point where pawn takes pawn happens? No, we get out of the way of the bishop attack. I guess this pawn takes pawn threat is going to force the bishop to move one day. Because white doesn't have any defenders of the critical e5 square. The bishop can't defend that square. Players are satisfied with that outcome. White ran out of attacking pieces. Attack failed to materialize. There's all these pawns which are slow moving. And black is taking the center, but my goodness. I would not have thrown in the towel there. Now I'm. Perhaps in this case, because this wasn't a 10-second game, this wasn't simply a case of flag fall. Perhaps this is a case where the player just voluntarily lost on time because they just don't see anything. Maybe. I'm in no way qualified to speak on that subject, but that perhaps might have been what was going on here. I don't know. Azish, yeah, shogi. We haven't done this in forever. Nice players wrapped up pretty quickly at the end. That seems to me to suggest either that one of them had to leave or that it's pretty clear to both of them what's going on here. And given the time situation, I'm inclined to say that Black is just winning this. But what do I know? Sure looks like this is starting to loosen up. Black does not have pawns on these B, C, and D files. Or he does have one on D file, but he could potentially add pawns on the B and C files if he ever gets more pawns. I don't know. This seems confusing to me still. The center is falling apart. Black did manage to put up a knight defending this pawn that cuts off the bishop, and it looks like Black is making some inroads, but it's not entirely clear to me. Either way, the player's left, so what can you do? Alright, can we look at this game? There's a slower game. Hopefully, we won't have another player losing on time again. Free pawn. That's totally what happened there. Just kidding. Does anybody understand this position? Both players have castled to the right. So I would expect that the 4 Don would be better off than the 3 Don. All other considerations being the same, which they never are, but so I'm trying to find a way to justify that in terms of this position. I mean, it looks like Black's rook is centralized right here. His bishop is pretty active. He's now promoted his bishop. So now can move one square in any direction, or can move like a bishop. Now that's a bit imprecise. It technically can move like a gold. Here's how a gold moves. Or can move like a bishop. So a gold can go this way, can go that way, can go this way, can go that way, can go this way, can go back one. It cannot go diagonally backward. Unlike its comrade, the silver, which can go diagonally backward, can go forward in any direction, but cannot go sideways or backward. So that's what those pieces indicate. I find that much easier for me than trying to understand the Japanese set. So, I have forgotten what I set my stream title to, but I think it's like the learning games. Probably a better title would just be Shogi. This is a bit lower key because I'm not actually playing the games and getting my rear end handed to me. Just watching. Watching, waiting, commentating. So note, if pawn takes pawn, promoting this, Black could counter by placing a promoted pawn right over here, hitting the lance, hitting the knight. The knight's probably worth more than the lance, but But yeah, that's one consideration protecting this pawn is that currently the pawn cannot go here due to doubled pawns, which would lose instantly because double pawns are illegal. But if pawn takes pawn happens, then player can place the pawn on that same file. Or rather, if you don't have a pawn on a given file, you can place a pawn on that file. There might be other squares that are better to place that pawn on. Perhaps center file. Yeah, like right there. I was thinking one more square forward, but no, I like this better. So that supports any kind of piece that he wants to drop right in front of it. Oh, the promoted pieces, just like they move like the original pieces. But they also inherit the powers of the gold general. I think there's exceptions to this. Like a promoted knight only moves like a general. I'm sorry, let me back up. A promoted piece moves like a gold general, with exception for the rook and with exception for the bishop. Or the rook moves like a rook or like a gold, or the bishop moves like a bishop or a gold. But any other promoted piece just moves like a gold. Note that you can't promote a king, but it wouldn't matter anyway because a king already moves like a gold or moves like a king. So, which one's the gold? It's this guy, the one that's got six directions he can move. He just can't go diagonally backward. That's his only constraint. Everything else promotes to a gold, basically. A gold promotes to a gold, so what's the point there, really? You note that you cannot place a knight or a lance such that it has no legal moves. So, like, if you're placing a piece in your opponent's territory and you end up placing a knight on the back rank, that's illegal because your knight can't move. If you place it on the second to last rank, that's also illegal because a knight on that rank still only moves forward two squares into the side one. Knights don't move like chess knights. For example, like, this knight does not protect this knight. They don't in any way defend each other. Knight only moves two and one. But yeah, everything else promotes to a gold, other than a rook or a bishop. But they retain their original symbology for the most part, so that, well, at least for this English, anglicized version of the pieces, you know when you're capturing a piece, what it unpromotes into. So if you capture this pawn down here, that's not a gold, that becomes a pawn again. Yeah, right, that's the point. Sorry it took me a while to articulate that. I haven't had to explain the rules in a very long time. So I was saying this pawn defends anything that might want to be placed right in front of it. Well, look at that. We got a general standing in front of our pawn. We got a rook backing up the pawn, backing up the general. Got a silver that's hitting the rook, that's hitting this general. The general cannot capture backward diagonally because this is a gold. However, silver can capture backward diagonally. But if he does that, the pawn's going to take him. But gold is usually thought to be more powerful than silver. So this is kind of a sacrifice here. But I'm sure he's getting something out of it, or he wouldn't have done it. Oh, he's got another pawn. Is that pawn going to go right here? Because then that pawn could take the knight, and that could take the lance, and we could slowly move around, taking things one at a time. Or are we going to place more things on the center file? Oh, you can't do that because the knight defends that square. Never mind. Rook takes bishop. That is one fun sack. Now that rook doesn't look like a rook anymore. It now looks like a dragon. And then we have our bishop taking whatever that was. So, yeah, two pieces for a rook, and one of those pieces being a bishop is probably fine. In the same way, like in Bug House, getting two knights for a queen is good, or something like that. So, while it's fun to go capturing things, it remains important in this game to remember to go after your opponent's king. If you never build up an attack on the king, well, all your excursions collecting material are for naught. So that bishop is attacked by the gold that just moved. By that bishop, I mean the one in red here. Gold takes bishop as a threat. Maybe he's considering sacking it for some reason. I don't know. This is true. Yeah, promoted bishop is no longer constrained to a single, we'll say, square color. Whereas an unpromoted bishop is constrained based on what color squares it can move to. There's really no reason not to promote a bishop. So you promote when you enter or leave the promotion zone, or maybe even when you're moving within it. Promotion zone being the top three ranks of the board, or the bottom three if you're the opponent here. So as you enter or leave that space, you can promote. Or maybe even as you move within that space, because you're either entering, leaving, or both in that case. Oh, that's a defensive piece. I was going to say, why did an attacking piece go there? That didn't happen. Gold takes gold. Gold doesn't have any need to promote, because it would promote to a gold anyway. Silvers, if they make it to that other side, can continue being silvers, or they can promote to golds. But if they get gold powers, they lose their silver power. There's a bishop. There's a bishop rook plus gold, or a bishop rook plus king. Oh, well, I guess it's equivalent for a bishop. Yeah, I'm sorry, yeah, you're right. That for a rook, it's actually you move like a king. Or you move, like a rook. But yeah, for a bishop, you move like a king or you move like a bishop. It's an accurate way to describe it. I forgot how the promoted rook, which is called a dragon, how that moves. I want to say that promoted bishop is not called a dragon. Yeah. That's what I was getting confused, is I just didn't remember that a promoted rook could actually move one square in any direction. Okay, Whoa, what's this about? What's this noise? Oh, never mind. I didn't see that this knight was defending the silver here. So I was wondering why, when the silver went there, wasn't that just a free silver? I missed the fact that this knight had entered play. So, okay, you got the king to move. It's probably going to move back soon. So, what's your big plan? You got a plan, right? interesting looking at these games and seeing how knights tend not to move from their start positions. Just having seen a number of high-level games today, seems like those knights just don't move. Whereas in chess, a knight's a really tricky piece and it has all kinds of fun movement. Here, that's not the case. Okay, we place another silver. That silver is defended, so the options white has are gold take silver or run with the king. Could either run toward the silver or away from it. Not sure which of those three moves is best. I'm sure they all have some pros and some. Wait, no, you can't go toward it because there's the gold right there. Never mind, I was just making that up to test you. Just kidding. So yeah, I forgot this gold is a friendly piece, so it supports these friendly pieces. This king is going to be overcome by friendliness. It's going to be the friendliest attack that Black has ever waged. That's kind of amazing. I've never seen three generals and a knight that close to an opposing king, just sitting there waiting for Godot. Maybe White is a bit overwhelmed by all that friendliness. It's kind of amazing that White has six pieces in hand. Alright, now we're going to start exchanging. Looks like White is offering a gold for a silver. Will Black take it? And if so, which gold for which silver? Okay, so exchanges that silver for the gold on the back rank. Okay. So now, if he had another silver in hand, he could place it right here, or he could take his gold in hand and place it right there too. You just can't place pawns over here because the pawn, you can't double pawns, so the closest pawn he could place to this king would have to be here. And that really doesn't help as far as I see. All right, so he places the gold that he just captured. Now if gold takes gold, then gold takes gold in reply. And yeah, if you just put another piece, say, on the square between the gold and the king, I'm sure the silver will take it. Yeah. Once your first time expires, you go into Byo-Yomi for every move thereafter. So we saw gold takes as predicted. Apparently, this is how you wage an attack. You just keep placing pieces one square closer at a time, and if your opponent can't do anything to stop it, just keep going. Okay, the king's making a run away from all the friends. Maybe he's got time to wage an attack of his own. Honestly, a move that I would have expected for quite some time might have been rook down here, and then bishop takes gold. So, it's really a question of timing. All right. The king gets out of the way, so this lance defends the pawn. This is looking bad. Okay, I mean, yeah, the king got away from these guys. But can he run from everybody? Usually not. Okay, yeah, you did have to block. And I guess the least valuable blocker was a silver. Oh boy. Oh boy. Wait, this knight is not defended. Is it? Wow. Maybe capture backward here to get a piece close to that king. No. Okay. Well, the king's gonna run probably toward the northwest corner. Jeez. It looks like he's getting away with it too, which surprises me. Okay, king takes knight. Unless you can find some kind of attacking move. Well, that threatens mate. No, it's not mate. So yeah, just run with the king. King takes knight. King is threatening to take the gold. Not sure if there's a good way to protect your gold or what is appropriate here. You don't have a bishop, you don't have a rook, because your opponent has both rooks and both bishops. So if your attack fails, you're screwed. Okay, so the golds defend each other, and this is check, but oh, we run forward. Of course. That makes sense. As long as the king's getting away safely. I see rook, bishop, rook, bishop all belong to white. So as long as white has all the ranged pieces, black might be in trouble. Ding, ding. Okay, we're gonna lure the bishop away from the defense of the king. Most importantly, defense of this particular square, from where some cheapos might happen. Not sure if that's the only point. Not even sure if that matters. Okay, we lured the bishop away from this square. So, my sight was off by a square here. This square's covered, this square's covered. So, maybe pawn here, king back, placing another gold could be a threat. Black's starting to run out of threats. I think. Gold here, right? Just place a gold. This one, right? Nope, not there. Here. Yeah. This has to be tried. You can't let the king run away into this corner, nor can you let it run away into this corner, so you have to try this. Is this good enough? Golds tend to be pretty bad at checkmating. Yeah, you're gonna try to go for some sort of perpetual check, but I don't know. This is looking sad. Yeah. Okay, you have to take that. And now white gets to attack, maybe? Not sure why that was so great. I guess that defends this square. I thought this square was already defended somehow, but I'm obviously hallucinating that. Okay, so we got four golds trying to do something. If nothing else, to cover as many squares as possible so that king doesn't mate us. Or not the king, but so that this army of devastation that's just sitting here does not have time to destroy us. Okay, knight there. Your king's gotta run now. I'm sure bishop. No. Yeah, maybe. Silver's probably cheaper. It's amazing how hard it is to access squares next to this king. Pawn's on a roll. Okay, we got a bishop at last. So finally black has a ranged piece. What's going on here? I guess pawn takes pawn on the rank. On the edge of the board. This is a useful defensive maneuver, just to get more space for the king to run in. Yeah, that blocking move confuses me. I don't understand why that pawn advanced to block the check. Okay, so that threatens lance takes pawn mate. Subtle, but is that really gonna work? What? Good game? Jeez, either that was a cheapo or there was no stopping it. Probably just a cheapo, but oh wow, what a game. That's like if you checkmate your opponent with a pawn in chess. You don't expect that to happen. Jeez, well, clearly, we've learned everything there's possibly to learn about shogi. Is there a way I can export this game? I know there's Khifu. Options, nope. Whatever, we did observe the game live as it unfolded. This is one cool looking game. What would have been the key point to this whole attack? How about not getting checkmated on the last move of the game? I think that might be key. Yeah, let's save that to KIF. Let's put that on our desktop. Sure, whatever. Deal with it later. What a game. What a game. There might have been critical points earlier in the game. I think we've learned everything there's ever that we'll need to learn about shogi. Oh, he's saying something. Maybe. Or he KO3C left. I assume this means there's an audio channel established, but I mean, they don't necessarily speak English anyway. So, how about that game? Alright, should we try one? Oh, man. No, I don't feel up to trying a game at the moment. Sorry. Let's watch one more. Sorry for teasing with that. Let's watch a quick game. Oops. Back to game, back to lobby. Let's watch this. Ooh, this one's unraveling quickly. Maybe I'll be up to shogi some other time. Just not feeling it at the moment. It's sides. This is awesome to spectate. This is like if you were to log on ICC and just watch the Masters play all day. This is subsidized by the Japanese Shogi Association, so in that way it is similar to ICC, but Japan actually supports its arts, as opposed to requiring member nations to have players that support the federations that support them, etc. Here, I assume the government is helping pay for the sciences and arts, so I might assume incorrectly, but I hope I don't. All right, so, oh wow. So lately we've been seeing the king move to defend things a little bit. Here we see the king just all the way that happened. Not only did the silver step out of the way of this bishop, no longer attacking the bishop, but it also cleared the way to just go to the lance. And now this is a weak spot right here. So this caught me by surprise, this development. Oh wait, there's this friendly bishop here. Yeah, it looks like white's getting mated. Not just normally, but super mega dead mated with very few defensive prospects. Yeah, this does not look good for white. White's stubborn. White's gonna try to hang in there. But yeah. Wait, what? Okay, so we sacked a rook and a bishop. There had better be a checkmate or something really convincing on the tail end of that. Oh, the king cannot go diagonally back here because the gold cuts that off. Players agree the game is over. I assume because this king is very quickly getting mated from where it stands. This is a bishop back here, so this is cut off. This is cut off. Knight defends this silver. So the king could advance. No, he can't, because all these squares are cut off. So it could go back to one of these two squares, and then I'm sure some sort of attack starting here would be devastating. So, yeah. That's shogi in a nutshell, guys. We'll have to try and play it someday. Just not feeling aggressive and energetic enough to try to both commentate and play at the same time. So we'll save that for a time where feeling a little bit more energetic, a little bit less laid back. All right, so that was fun. Yeah, thanks for watching. Sorry to be cutting the things at this point. But, you know, we'll always have more time. Been managing to set aside some of my coding projects lately. I did find out that that my attempt to make a Lee Chess client in that one that runs on Windows is predicated on having some kind of platform that can handle secure sockets, that can handle the SSL socket security layer technology. And that just doesn't work very well on Windows. So I've reconsidered the priority of trying to make a desktop client for Lee Chess because it's beyond the technical limitations of Windows. It's just going to be a challenging task in general. And I've got enough challenging tasks in my moment, at this moment. So I've managed to set that aside. I know the other day I was tinkering with natural language processing a little bit. The libraries don't even compile anymore, so I can set that aside and not worry about it. It's just too much of a technical hassle to be bothered with at this point. And yeah, just been managing to set priorities in terms of which projects and things I'm working on, so I'm finding more time to do things that are important. So that's a good thing. So yeah, maybe everybody else has their own resolutions for the new year. Mine's just trying to better prioritize stuff. And yeah, it's just going to be a learning effort in general, but we'll see how we do. All right, so yeah, thanks for watching, and see you next time.